always look at the time, if it is afternoon.
Yes, sir.
Then you should wish the boat down.
Okay, sir.
Okay, and second advice, button or anything you have to do with your coat, you can do it outside.
Okay, sir.
Right?
Thank you, sir.
Third is, when you enter, your hands should be straight.
Yes, sir.
So three things, remember.
Okay, sir.
So, Vivekananda Shukla. So, Vivekananda, how do you feel after having qualified the returns of civil services?
Sir, I feel it more challenging to clear the next exam because I have gotten an opportunity. So, at one place I am happy, and at the other I am also more ready to fight the next stage.
You are more ready to?
Fight the next stage, interview.
Fight the next stage? Is it a fight?
A challenge.
Okay, okay. So I find you did your graduation. Just tell me about yourself. Your, from where, what is your father doing?
Okay, sir.
Oh, your father lived in Shukla.
Yes, sir.
What was he doing?
Sir, he was working as a laborer in Telangana in a paper factory. I was also born there itself. I had my education up to class 12 from Telangana in Jawahar Navodaya Vidyalaya. Thereafter, I moved to Banaras Hindu University to complete my graduation. And in 2017, I wrote an entrance exam for the post of scientific assistant in Indian Meteorological Department. In 2019, I joined it, and right presently, I am employed there, sir, in Gaya.
Okay, okay. And your mother, is she working somewhere?
No, sir. She is a
homemaker.
Yes, sir.
These days the term used is homemaker.
Homemaker. Thank you, sir.
Housewife has become very outdated.
Yes,
all right. Why do you want to join civil services? You are very young. You have done your physics honors with chemistry and maths.
Subsidiary subjects.
Subsidiary?
Yes.
Okay. So why do you want to come to civil services?
Sir, it was my objective since my school days to get into civil services, because it is a post in which a single person, if he is dedicated, then he can positively affect the lives of many people. Mm-hmm. So this was something that attracted me towards his service.
So touching the life of many people?
Positively.
Positively.
Yes, sir.
Is that all? Means, what are the qualities that you look for in a civil servant?
Sir, firstly, he should be hardworking. He should be able to interact with many people, co-worker motivation. He should be interested in field visits. These are some of the qualities that a civil servant should have to make desired impacts on the society, sir.
That's all.
No, sir, there are many other also, like leadership skills, honesty.
What qualities you should have, and how many of those qualities you are having?
Sir, leadership skills you must have. You must have the ability to manage, to have a balanced viewpoint in discussions on various issues. He must be able to take certain risks at specified times. He should not be averse towards taking risks, we can say. He should be able to handle difficult situations.
Okay, okay, okay. Nowadays, number of Indians are heading multinational companies, especially IT sector companies.
Yes, sir.
Of the world.
Yes, sir.
And these are the Indian origin people.
Yes, sir.
So what qualities you think a CEO of Indian origin has got that he is commanding the world in the IT sector?
Sir, 3 to 4 things I would say, sir. One, the hard-working capability, as Indians are known for their hard work. Secondly, sir, ability to adjust in different atmospheres, to act conducively in different atmospheres. In most of the companies are multinational. A CEO must have such a quality to adjust in different socio-economic atmospheres. Along with that, sir, innovation and leadership. These are also qualities for which Indians in many multinational companies are known.
Okay. There are many more qualities because of which Indian especially, because these are common qualities which anybody can have.
Yes.
Being born in India, connect your culture and then you will find the answer.
Social bonding.
You'll speak more than one language.
Yes, sir.
Then he will have more empathy towards others.
Yes.
Then hard working, you have already said there are many other qualities that because of the cultural aspect,
yes,
of India one acquires. Okay? Vivekananda.
Yes,
yes. Tell us about Swami Vivekananda and his contribution to the world.
Yes. Sir, he was first cultural ambassador of India to the West. He was a yogic personality, said to have supernatural intellect. Throughout the world, he is famous as an inspiration source for the youth. He is a youth icon. He was the one who transformed the nature of discourse on patriotism, on interfaith awareness, on religious brotherhood. These were some of his qualities for which he was known throughout the world, sir. He was very famous for his quotations, for his motivational speeches. He also founded Ramakrishna Mission, which even today is a great philanthropic organization. So these were some of his contributions, sir, for which he is well known.
What was his contribution during the speech in Chicago? Was there anything special in his Chicago speech?
Yes, sir. He began the speech with a statement that sisters and brothers of America, for a world order of that period, this was a very special statement in which a person who was said to represent a particular religion was talking with people of other religions as in terms of sisters and brothers. This was very new in that atmosphere, sir.
And the length of speech.
Yes, sir.
Nobody else could speak for that long. How many hours he spoke?
I do not remember exactly, but more than 1 hour using a very hard vocabulary.
More than 1 hour, no, my dear. He spoke more than one day. It spilled on to the next day.
Okay, sir, I will try to know what.
Okay. Thanks. Tell us about your district, Sala. The three most challenging socio-economic aspects of Sala, and how could you improve those aspects if you are given a chance to of posting in that district?
Sir, first challenge is of floods and drought, both are frequent. Secondly, sir, it is about overpopulation. And thirdly, sir, it is unemployment, lack of enough economic activity. These three, I think, sir, are major challenges in Saran district. If I ever get a chance to serve in that area, on the first component regarding floods and droughts, I think, sir, there is a vast scope of improvement because it is actually a convergence point of three perennial rivers. If construction such as embankments, stoppage on sand mining and other such steps are taken, then floods can surely be fought. Secondly, sir, on the issue of unemployment, I think, sir, the district has a huge potential for tourism industry. Along with that, food processing industry. Sugarcane, which was once a very known commercial crop in that area, due to industrial collapse of a single sugar mill, the entire sugarcane cultivation has been reduced. So if we invest in tourism and food processing industry, I think, sir, economy can be revived. And as far as the overpopulation component is concerned, the density of my district is 1500 per square kilometer compared with the density of Bihar, which is around 1100 square per kilometer. So I think, sir, even on that aspect, we need to work by creating awareness and family planning mechanisms so that population can be contained.
You talked of overpopulation of this district.
Yes, sir.
What about India? What should be done to control and contain the population of India.
Sir,
if you ever get a chance, what three important steps would you take on the population front?
Sir, firstly, a lot of things have been done, which is reflected in our present fertility rate. So presently the focus should be on a voluntary awareness amongst people, because already the fertility rate is down. The present scenario that we are seeing is due to the historical explosion of population. That momentum is being carried up, is currently carrying away the population figures, sir. So now what we need to do is that is work on awareness component, especially among certain communities in whom the fertility rate is still higher. So if that thing we are able to do, then I think, sir, we will be able to contain population to a certain level.
You mean to say you will tackle India's population problem by segregating and finding out the rate of growth of population in each segment? That may not be workable.
Sir, by each segment I meant by each region, because in South India we already have a fertility rate below 2. In specific states in North India, like in Bihar and Assam, the fertility rate is still around 3. So if in those regions we can work more, then naturally, sir, the population can be slowed down, population growth can be slowed down.
Okay, you are a physics graduate.
Yes, sir.
How well conversant are you with the latest IT technologies?
Sir, I have
any idea of what machine learning is and
yes,
what is cryptocurrency?
Yes, sir.
And what is RBI's decision on cryptocurrency?
Sir, cryptocurrency is
machine learning first.
Okay, sir. Sir, machine learning is a process through which a system acquires data and learns through it in terms of cognitive decision making. In the process of its working, it acquires data, analyzes it, and the machine itself learns to take cognitive decisions. Cryptocurrency, sir, it is a virtual currency. It can also be said as a commodity which is used to trade in the cyber world. So far it does not have any legal backing in India. Recently the RBI had decided to stop trade in cryptocurrency, but the Supreme Court decision which came a few days ago said that there cannot be no blanket ban on cryptocurrency trade in India.
In fact, there was no ban. What Supreme Court had said was something else. RBI had also not banned cryptocurrency. RBI had stopped transacting through banks. And once you don't have a bank account, you can't trade in cryptocurrency.
Thanks.
Okay, tell me, use of IT for smart policy, how will you use information technology for smart policy?
Yes, sir. There are specific technologies like drone, in terms of IT, sir, like facial recognition, like CCTV. These can be used in areas where crowd management is an issue. Here's one thing, sir. Secondly, through IT systems, we have the potential to acquire a large amount of data through which smart policing can be done by learning through experiences in specific segments. Especially in if you are able to identify through data the criminal hotspots in a particular city or in a particular region, then if we can try to increase policing in those particular spots. Thirdly, sir, using IT, we can have a national crime database in which people who have a criminal background, they can be monitored for their activities. These are some of the ways in which IT can be used.
Okay, you know any country which has got 3 capitals? Any country in the world?
Sir, I'm sorry, sir, I cannot recall.
You don't recall? There is a saying that America never loses wars, it loses interest in wars.
Yes.
Can you justify this statement?
Sir, a war is said to be lost when a country is completely defeated. In all the wars that America has so far engaged in, it has not been completely defeated. It has just retracted back to its original position. So in that sense, we can say that it has not lost war, it has just lost interest in war. Now interest here specifies its strategic and economic interests. When these interests are met, it retracts back to its original position. So this statement can refer to this.
So name the countries where it has retraced its steps.
Sir, we can see it in Afghanistan. Presently it is happening, it is in this process. We can also see it in, we had seen in Vietnam and in the Gulf War crisis of the 1990s, where it has retreated after establishing its objectives. It has retreated back to its original position.
Okay. You have worked as a scientific assistant.
Yes.
And you are still working.
Yes.
In Indian Meteorological Department.
Yes.
So, what are the challenges that the department is facing currently?
Yes, sir. First is the manpower challenge. In this regard, steps have been taken, but still we have a lack of scientific manpower, especially in higher positions. Secondly, sir, it is about data centers from where we are able to get data. There is a large Himalayan belt where we do not have enough observatories. We are unable to get data through many parts of the Indian Ocean. So naturally, it is a difficult task to forecast accurately. Thirdly, sir, the equipments that the department currently has, especially in outstation observatories, most of them are outdated. Fourthly, a novel concept emerged in the IMD about automatic weather stations. Had it been successful, our data collection and forecasting capability would have been increased drastically, but it has not been very successful due to maintenance issues. So these are some of the challenges, sir, in IMD.
Okay, but in forecasting, yes, suppose if we encourage private sector,
yes,
do we have a challenge?
Sir, if we do encourage private sector, then there are certain conclusions that we can draw, sir. One is the quality of prediction can surely increase because competition will increase. But on the other hand, there is this concern of liability. Private companies may not be liable when a prediction goes wrong. But on the other hand, IMD being a government institute has a liability as well as a social responsibility. So while we can encourage private participation, but that cannot be a complete alternative to IMD's work.
Okay. Now you talked about the food processing industry. There's a potential in your district.
Yes.
Regarding food processing industry.
Yes.
What is food processing industry?
It is an industry in which after harvesting of a crop, the crop before being sold into the markets, it is processed to make more productive products. For example, potato can be processed into chips, or sugar cane can be processed into other products.
Okay, do you have idea about any initiative that government is taking?
Yes, sir. There are schemes like Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sampada Yojana. There are schemes to establish cold storage infrastructures, primary collection centers, central collection centers, in a hub and spoke model.
In which, so government has already initiated this program.
Yes.
And I think government has initiated this program in 2009.
Yes.
But these are not bringing some results.
Yes, sir.
And concrete results, especially in Bihar and Uttar Pradesh region.
Yes, sir.
Why it is not happening?
Sir, because these steps work on one aspect, but there are many other aspects to make the scheme successful, like the supply side. The productivity itself is not very high. Secondly, for food processing, we need uniformity of products, which is not the case presently in areas of Bihar, where the land size is very low. Thirdly, sir, in spite of these schemes, we also need other reforms, like integration of agricultural marketing areas, APMCs. Such steps need to be converged with the present schemes to make it a success holistically, in a holistic manner. This has to be done, sir. So far, on this integration component, much has not been done, sir.
Okay, but what can you do for encourage that integration?
Sir, firstly, there are certain model laws like Model Land Leasing Act, Model Contract Farming Act, these need to be implemented by the state governments. Secondly, sir, we need to increase schemes like cooperative farming, farmer producer organizations. We need to work on new export destinations. We need to modify schemes like Essential Commodities Act. These are the legislative aspects. On the other hand, until and unless physical infrastructure and connectivity is created in especially rural and agricultural areas, the scheme would be very difficult to make it a success. So on these two parameters, I think, sir, we need to work more.
Okay. So you talked about Model Land Leasing Act.
Yes, sir.
So this Model Land Leasing Act, how far it can boost food processing industry?
Sir, by land leasing, the small land sizes that are presently available, they can be leased to cooperative farmer companies, farmer producer organizations, or in rare cases to the food processing industry itself, so that uniformity of product is created in vast areas in which there's a win-win situation for both for the industry as well as for the farmers.
Any other benefit of land leasing? This is again you talk about, that is the benefit of cooperative farming as well.
Yes.
Okay, so land consolidation. You talk about land consolidation.
Yes.
But tell me land leasing, how land leasing will bring some kind of change?
Sir, the land that is presently available, it can be developed in a more useful manner by delegating specific parts for agriculture, remaining for infrastructure. So, so there is a possibility that development would be more planned and more productive. In this way, sir, I think we can help.
Okay, have you heard about contract farming?
Yes, sir.
What are the benefits of contract farming?
Sir, on the farmer side, benefits include help by the companies in the input stage. Secondly, assured procurement after harvesting. Thirdly, benefits such as insurance, availability of credit, etc. On the side of the industry, it has benefits like uniformity of raw material, assured supply.
What is uniformity of raw material means?
Uniformity of the harvest. For example, if a particular crop is being sown, in contract farming, there are specific parameters that the crops should have before harvesting. So in that sense, sir, there is uniformity in the crop. Secondly, sir, industry also benefits as there is assured supply.
Hmm.
So these are some of the benefits, sir,
and
for
what
both
are the challenges?
Sir, challenges include, for the first challenge is, sir, for contract farming, we need large amount of land for which farmers need to come together. So this is the biggest challenge, sir. Along with that, we need ease of doing business because contract farming entails a lot of legislative aspects also. Contract enforcement, which is not very good in India. So these challenges are to be dealt with, sir.
Okay, so you have studied physics, chemistry and mathematics.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Can you explain mathematics in simple words?
Mathematics is a subject of numbers. It is a tool that is necessary to understand all sciences present in the world.
And how your knowledge of physics, chemistry, mathematics will help you in public administration or in civil services?
Sir, the science subjects, they teach us about theories and applicability. Whenever something goes wrong, there lies some problem with the theory which needs to be changed. So this principle, sir, is valid in public administration also. If we are unable to implement something successfully, then we need to look at the problem from the base itself. So this is something that will help me, sir. And along with that, today governance is becoming more scientific in terms of technology, in terms of interaction with people. So having a background in science will naturally help, I think, sir.
Okay, then why you took geography as an optional subject?
Sir, it was my interest in school days itself to learn geography. But given my family conditions and certain objectives, I could not opt for it in the graduation stage. So this I realized it as an opportunity to venture to explore a new subject.
Okay. So tell us something special about India's geography.
Sir, India is a subcontinent in which most of the examples of physical geography can be seen, which are present throughout the world. India is the only country which has its unique geography in terms of world's largest mountains, one of the largest rivers, and its entire ocean named behind with the name of a country. So these are some unique aspects of Indian geography, sir.
Okay, what is a wetland, or what are wetlands, and why they are called kidneys of the planet?
Yes, sir. Sir, wetlands are areas in which the water depth is at least 3 meters. These are hotspots of ecosystems and biodiversity, very important indicators of pollution-free environment, supports a large number of organisms, and hence they are called kidneys of the world, because they help in recycling of environmental waste in sustainable development, as well as in completing the environmental cycles like carbon cycle, nitrogen cycle, etc.
Okay, and how do agriculture growth and economic development,
yes, sir,
go hand in hand?
Sir, agriculture is one of the most important sectors of economy, including manufacturing and services. In the context of India, sir, nearly half of the population is still engaged in agriculture. So naturally, to move in a developmental trajectory, these 40 to 50% of the population needs to be developed, for which agriculture is necessary. Secondly, sir, in the era of climate change, agriculture is severely affected. So if we are talking for long-term growth, then we need to invest significantly in sustainable agriculture. Thirdly, this green revolution, we have seen that the economic development of India has fastened. Same thing, even today, if we go up for second green revolution and work on the mission of doubling farmers' income, our economic pace of economic development can be further increased.
Okay, and your hobby is also playing cricket. Don't you think IPL should be scrapped due to fears of coronavirus?
Sir, public health is paramount, sir. So, if we are able to have certain developments up to the month of April or May, in which IPL is presently scheduled, then
scheduled in March.
So what we can do is that if we have any solution to it, then in the coming months, then we can use those solutions to fight against coronavirus. But if we are unable to have any technological advance in that sphere, then it can be delayed, sir, in winter or if for the next year, because public health is paramount.
Okay, and one last question. Why did you choose even foreign services as your later preferences after IRS and other preferences?
Sir, it was a matter of preference, sir, because for me, sir, I think economy is a segment which holds the key for development in all other sectors. If the revenues and economic of a government is good, if the finances are good, then naturally in all other segments, the governmental process will work better. So I was internally compelled to prefer to the revenue services after the administrative ones.
Okay. So one more question, since you talked about finance and economy.
Yes, sir.
What is your take on current crisis in this bank?
Sir, the crisis occurred due to unhealthy lending to specific companies like DHFL, etc. Recently, government has moved with SBI to acquire around 49% stakes in Yes Bank to revive investor confidence. So this problem mainly emerged due to lack of monitoring and lack of transparency in lending. If that could have been stopped, then probably such a crisis would not have occurred. So in the coming future, I think, sir, we need to work on the transparency component as well as monitoring of loans. We need to work on public credit registry, in which each organization and individual who has borrowed a large sum is rated adequately to understand the health of the loans given to him or that organization. So these are the things we need to work for in future, sir. Presently, SBI is handling the situation, and government needs to come up with certain other steps also to revive investor confidence.
before we close your mock interview.
Yes, sir.
Tell me about your Navodaya Vidyalaya.
Yes, sir.
What is so special about Jawahar Navodaya Vidyalaya?
For 7 years, almost free education and quality education is provided in Navodaya Vidyalayas. It is a residential school. So when we lived there for 7 years with our friends, with our teachers, naturally Guru Shishya Parampara is established. Along with that, sir, it identifies rural talent and provides them with facilities like gym, like co-curricular activities, number of awareness programs, cultural and sports meets. These are these things would not have been possible for people from rural children to experience had they not been in Navodaya. So these are some unique qualities, sir, of Navodaya schools.
Okay. We close your mock here.
Yes, sir.
You can just hold. We call you.
Thanks.